أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praises due to Allah. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon His last messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. First of all, I'd like to thank this Masjid al-Sabreen community under the leadership of our beloved Sheikh فضيلة الشيخ السيد عبد العزيز حفظه الله and the administration of the masjid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them who facilitated this event. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Inshallah, the format is like you have the index cards. So please write your questions, inshallah. This way you use the time efficiently. Write your question and try to make it, inshallah, brief and to the point. And then, inshallah, someone will bring the cards over here, and then I will moderate, inshallah, giving them to the sheikh so he can answer them, inshallah. Right, so inshallah, yani, the format would be that you submit your questions here, inshallah, yani, you submit the questions and then bi'idhnillah ta'ala will answer them, inshallah, rabbil alameen. The sheikh will give a couple of minutes first, inshallah, as an introduction, then after that we will go on with your question and answer so you can use the time efficiently, inshallah. فضيلة الدكتور صلاح الصاوي, أستاذ الدكتور صلاح الصاوي هو الأمين العام لمجمع فقهاء الشريعة. He is the Secretary General of AMJA, Assembly of Muslim Jurists of America. وأيضا هو رئيس جامعة المشكاة, جامعة الإسلامية بأمريكا الشمالية. And also he is the President and the Founder of Mishkah University, Islamic University of North America. The Sheikh, ما شاء الله, more than 45 years in the da'wah and in fiqh, in jurisprudence and fatawa and all of that. The sheikh does not need more introduction. You can just put his name on the sheikh Google and the sheikh Google will tell you everything, inshallah. MashaAllah, Rabbil Alameen. So this is an effort. I'm trying to speak English only so we can use the time, inshallah. This is an effort in coordination between the Islamic Society of Greater Houston, ISGH, with all their facilities and masajid all over Houston, and Mishkah University. Mishkah University has a center also in Almeida, Mansard Road, and 610 and Almeida. So there is a center there for the masjid and the future university, inshallah, Mishkah University. So this is coordination between ISGH and Mishkah University. And the Dr. Salah is the chairman of the Ulama Committee of ISGH as well. So ISGH, mashallah, took a huge leap in gathering the scholarship of Houston under this umbrella, mashallah, ISGH. So inshallah, this is a coordination between ISGH and Mishkah University, inshallah. So without further ado, inshallah, I give the sheikh the mic to introduce, inshallah, a couple of minutes, and then we'll go with the question and the answer.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. اللهم إنا نسألك في مفتتح مجلسنا هذا أن تجعل اجتماعنا فيه اجتماعا مرحوما, أن تجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما, ألا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما. ثم أما بعد, فلا يشكر الله من لا يشكر الناس. إن الشكر موصول فضلت الشيخ سيد القائم على أمر هذا المسجد, ثم للإدارة التنفيذية شيخ شاه زاد ومولانا الشيخ بشير وإخوانه والمساعدون من حوله. أسأل الله جل وعلا أن يكتب لهم كل ما بذلوه في موازين حسناتهم, وأن يجدوه نورا يسعى بين أيديهم وبأيمانهم يوم القيامة, وأن يعقبهم هذا الجهد الكريم المبارك عافية في أبدانهم وسعة في أرزاقهم وصلاحا في ذرياتهم وحسنا في خاتمتهم, اللهم آمين. موضوع هذه الليلة فتوى نايت. الفتوى إعلام بالحكم الشرعي, بيان بالحكم الشرعي, تختلف عن القضاء. القضاء إلزام بالحكم الشرعي. إذا ذهبت إلى محكمة شرعية ألزمك القاضي بحكمه, إذا ذهبت إلى مفتي بيّن لك فقط, لا يملك سلطة ولا شرطة, يملك فقط أن يبين لك حكم الله
عز وجل. أول من تولى منصب الإفتاء من؟ الله جل جلاله. يسأفتونك قل الله يفتيكم. منصب الإفتاء منصب جليل القدر وخطير الشأن. وابن القيم له كتاب اسمه إعلام الموقعين عن رب العالمين. المفتي يوقع عن الله عز وجل. إذا كان منصب التوقيع عن رئيس أو ملك بالمقام الذي لا يجحد قدره، فكيف بالتوقيع عن رب العالمين مالك يوم الدين؟ إعلام بالحكم الشرعي. كم الشرعية؟ 5: الواجبات، المندوبات، المحرمات، المكروهات، المباحات. لا ينفك عمل من أعمال المكلفين عن حكم من هذه الأحكام 5. لقد كان سلفنا الصالح كانوا يتحوطون وكانوا يتورعون وكانوا تمتلئ نفوسهم خشية ووجلا إذا كانوا في مقام الإفتاء والتوقيع عن الله عز وجل. عبد الرحمن بن أبي ليلى يقول: أدركت 120 من الأنصار في المسجد، ما كان منهم من محدث إلا ود أن أخاه كفاه الحديث، وما كان منهم من مفت إلا ود أن أخاه كفاه الفتية. وكان أهل العلم فيما مضى إذا سئل أحدهم عن شيء من الحلال والحرام تعلوه الرحضاء وكأنما الموت أشرف عليه. آخر كلمة في هذه المقدمة القصيرة جدا، أن الفتوى تقوم على ركنين: العلم بالشرع، الدراية بالواقع. أي نقص في هذا الجانب أو في ذاك ينعكس على الفتوى بالنقص والقصور لا محالة. الدراية بالواقع، العلم بالشرع، لابد للفقيه أن يكون ملما بالأمر الذي يسأل عنه ويستفتى فيه، فإن لم يكن عليما به يلتمس ذلك عند الخبراء المتخصصين في هذه المسائل التي يسأل عنها ويستفتى فيها. فالفتوى مسؤولية مشتركة، نصفها عندك ونصفها عندي. نصفها عندك لأنك مسؤول عن الوقائع، نصفها عندي مسؤول عن القواعد والأحكام الشرعية. فاحذر أن تزيف وعي المفتي أو أن تستنطقه على النحو الذي تريد. المستفتي يبحث عن حكم الله عز وجل، لا يبحث عن حكم يوافق هواه. إن حقيقة التكليف إخراج المكلف عن داعية هواه حتى يكون عبدا لمولاه. هذه حقيقة التكليف الشرعية. فكن دقيقا جدا في عرض نازلتك لكي تأتيك الفتوى دقيقة بإذن الله. هذه مقدمة يسيرة، ثم نتابع بعد ترجمتها أسئلة حضراتكم واستفتاءاتكم.
After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salam and salam on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Shaykh quoted the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam: he is not thankful to Allah, he is not grateful to Allah who is not thankful and grateful to people as well. So based on that, the Shaykh give thanks to Imam of the Masjid, Shaykh Sayyid, and the director of the Masjid, and the brothers helping, you heard their name, and that Allah Azza Jal gives them those efforts, make it in the balance of their deeds in Yawm Al-Qiyamah, giving them health and expansion and provision and protection from diseases and protection in this dunya, and safety in Yawm Al-Qiyamah, and good ending in this dunya, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma Ameen. Then the Sheikh said tonight's subject of this gathering is Fatwa Night. And Fatwa Night, the Sheikh asked, what is a fatwa? The fatwa is to clarify or to show people the Islamic ruling, the Shari'i ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a certain affair or a certain matter or a certain question. The mufti, the one who does that, is the one who just explains to you what you're supposed to do without any power to make sure you follow it. So he does not have the power. He's different from a judge. The judicial aspect is when you are forced to do something, when it is, they make sure that you do what the ruling of the court of law does. So, but the mufti does not have police, does not have executive, does not have anyone to make sure that the fatwa is followed. So this is the difference between the qadi, the judge, and the mufti. Then the Sheikh said, who was the first one to take this position of fatwa, to give fatwa to people, to explain to them the ruling? Is Allah Azza Jalla himself. And the Sheikh quoted the ayah that Allah Azza Jalla telling Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they ask you about such and such, Allah is the one who is going to give you the fatwa. And that happened in the, that's mentioned in the Quran. Then the Sheikh said there is a book called I'lam al-Muqeen by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. He said they are the signers of Allah Azza Jalla. The scholars are the ones who sign on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the matters. You wanted to know what Allah Azza Jalla wants from you, so you ask a person of knowledge and that person of knowledge sign that fatwa. So if there is a person who have that power of signing on behalf of a king, you know how big of the position, nevertheless the position to sign on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Sheikh said there are five rulings, anything that we do as Muslims comes under them, which is the obligation, then after that al-fardu, ba'dan ya Sheikh
al-wajibat, al-mandubat, al-muharramat, al-makruhat, al-mubahat.
So the Sheikh said there are things which is obligations, and the things which is preferable, things which is permissible, and things which is disliked, and then things which is prohibited. One of five. Any action or anything that you do as a Muslim has to come under one of those categories. And then the Sheikh said that the guided predecessors, they used to avoid being in that position if they can. And then he mentioned a narration from one of the Tabi'een, Abdurrahman ibn Abi Layla. He said, I attended 120 of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Each one of them, he avoids to give a hadith or narrate a hadith from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he wished that his brothers, one of them would do it. And whenever they are asked about a fatwa, they will also avoid it if somebody else can do it. This is how powerful and how scary for them, and how careful they were of jumping and giving the fatwa. And then the Sheikh said, it is when somebody is asked about what is halal and what is haram, one of those scholars would look like he's about to die. He will turn pale and will be, you know, as if death is coming upon him, because he's afraid to say something haram, something halal, and then it is the other way around, and then people follow it. That is the degree of giving fatwa. Then the Sheikh went from there and he says that a mufti or a fatwa has two pillars. One is knowing the Islamic rulings. Two is knowing the reality around, is knowing the atmosphere, the circumstances, the reality around. So the knowledge of the Islam and its ruling, and the knowledge of the reality and the surroundings, the, you know, the community and the society, the context, knowing the context around. So the shortcoming or the defect in any one of those two pillars will result in a defect in the fatwa, in accuracy of the fatwa. So if a person knows the ruling of Islam but does not know the reality around, the fatwa would not come relevant. And if a person knows, you know, that but does not know the ruling, the fatwa would come defective, and so on. So the mufti has to have the balance between the two. But if he does not know, then he should ask the experts in the context that he is not aware of. This does not make the mufti the only one responsible, but the Sheikh said it's a mutual responsibility between the one who asks and the one who answers. Don't try, the Sheikh said, don't try to get a certain answers that you like. So you kind of format your question in accordance to that, so you make the mufti say a certain answer. You will be asked about that in Yawm al-Qiyamah, the Day of Judgment. So the Sheikh said, the whole point of this Sharia is to take us from following our own lusts and desires to follow what Allah Azza wa Jalla wants. That should be the concern of the person who asks, and should be the concern of the person who answers, is to please Allah according to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is very important that the Sheikh said, be very careful, that the more accurate you are in asking the question, the more accurate the question will come. So this is an introduction the Sheikh gave before, inshallah, we go with your questions, inshallah. So we'll just go straight to the questions. Nasiha. What advice can you give to high schoolers other than praying and reading Quran? إيه هي النصيحة يعني التي تنصح بها طلاب المدارس الثانوية شيخنا يعني فضلا عن الصلاة وقراءة القرآن؟
ننصحهم بالرفقة الصالحة، فإن مثل الجليس الصالح والجليس السوء كحامل المسك ونافخ القير، فحامل المسك إما أن يحذيك، وإما أن تبتاع منه، وإما أن تجد منه ريحا طيبة، ونافخ القير إما أن يحرق ثيابك أو أن تجد منه ريحا خبيثة. الله جل وعلا يقول: الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين. أنصحهم بقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: نعمتان مغبون فيهما كثير من الناس، الصحة والفراغ. يا بني، يا من تتمتع بصحتك وأنت في أوجك وفي مرحلة توهجك وتألقك وإقبالك على الدنيا وإقبال الدنيا عليك، اغتنم صحتك قبل مرضك، اغتنم فراغك قبل شغلك، اغتنم شبابك قبل هرمك. لا تغبن في الصحة، لا تغبن في الوقت. اعلم أن كل لحظة تمر بك سوف تسأل عنها يوم القيامة، فلن تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة حتى يسأل عن أربع، من بينها عن شبابه فيما أفناه، عن عمره فيما أنفقه وفيما أهدره. أرجو أن تدرك أن سفينة نوح في هذا البلد إنما هي المسجد، من ركبها نجا ومن تخلف عنها غرق. زر الله في بيته، اجتهد أن تصلي الفجر في جماعة لكي تكون في ذمة الله عز وجل. ثم بعد هذا أرجو أن توقر والديك وأن تعظمهما. لا تسري إليك أدواء هذا المجتمع، شعور بالندية وتهميش دور الوالد ومحاولة الاقتناع بأن أباءنا يمثلون عهدا قد ولى ودنيا قد غبرت، فلا يفهمون زماننا ولا يفهمون قضايانا، ولسنا مطالبين بأن نصغي إليهم ولا أن نستمع إليهم. إن كل هذا من تزيين الشيطان وإفكه. إن الشيطان لكم عدو فاتخذوه عدوا، إنما يدعو حزبه ليكونوا من أصحاب السعير. وأختم: أن تكون لك صلة بكتاب الله عز وجل، انظر في المصحف، لا تهجر. وقال الرسول: يا رب، إن قوم اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا، إن قوم اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا. وأختم بحزبة صغيرة: لو واحد عاش 60 سنة، عارفين كم سيصفو له فيها من العبادة؟ 20 سنة، لو أنت بتنام 8 ساعات، أدي تلت عمرك ضاع نوم، أدي 20 سنة ضاعت نوم. لو بتروح الشغل أو الجامعة 8 ساعات، أدي 20 سنة أخرى ضاعت في الشغل أو العمل. لو احسب منه كمان 15 سنة منذ أن ولدت إلى البلوغ قبل أن يجري عليك قلم التكليف، أدي 55 سنة. بينك من 60 كام؟ بينك 5 سنوات. لو بتأكل كل يوم في ساعة، لو بتستغل ساعة واحدة على الطعام، لو أكلت وجبتين وكل وجبة فيها نصف ساعة، واحدة من 24، يعني أدي 3 سنوات أخرى في الطعام والشراب، أصبحت 58 سنة، البقيلك من عمره كل 2 سنين. احسبها كده، هتلاقي المسألة خطيرة جدا، وأنت محتاج أن تستخدم كل لحظة تمر بك. ما جلس قوم مجلسا لم يذكروا الله تعالى فيه ولم يصلوا على نبيهم صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا قاموا على مثل جيفة الحمار، ثم كان عليهم يوم القيامة حسرة، ثم إن شاء الله عذبهم وإن شاء الله غفر لهم. اللهم اهد شبابنا يا رب، وخذ بنواصيهم إليك أخذ الكرام عليك. اللهم آمين.
شيخ، the Sheikh gave, mashallah, a beautiful answer to this young brother or sister who was in the high school. He said a few advices. I'll say them quickly, inshallah. One is be good, with good company. Make sure you are with good company, because good company is like the perfume vendor. You always smell good, or buy something, or take a sample. And the bad company is like, you know, the smith. You know, you'll always get burned. Your clothes will get burned, and you will have a bad smell all the time. So good company. That's number one. Number two, use your health and don't be deceived. As Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, those who are heedless about their time and about their health. So don't abuse those two. You have health Allah give you, and you have time that Allah azza wa jal give you. So use them both and utilize them efficiently. Then the Sheikh mentioned the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that no one is going to move from the place of hisab in front of Allah in yawm al-qiyamah, except after they are asked about few things. One of them is your youth and your life in general, how you spend them and how you use them. The Sheikh said that Nuh's ark at our time is the Islamic center at the masjid. So be among those who are in that ark, so you'll be saved. If you are out, you will be drowning. So this is also an advice to our youth and our young people. Visit Allah at His house and try to do Fajr in Jama'ah as much as you can. After that, the next advice is to respect your parents and don't let the shaitan come to you, don't let the disease of the larger society come to you, that our parents are from another era and another time, they don't understand and they cannot relate on what we do. So we don't have to listen to them and we just take whatever we can from them. This is the shaitan's strategy and this is the shaitan perception of parents. Don't listen to that. And be among those who are good to their parents. Shaitan is your enemy, so use him as your enemy. Your parents are your parents, you need to respect them, they are your key to Jannah. Then the Shaykh said the next thing after all of that is you have to have connection with the Book of Allah. Look at the Book of Allah, recite it and read it. And don't be among those whom Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will complain about Yawm al-Qiyamah that they deserted the Qur'an. They deserted the Qur'an. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will mention these people Yawm al-Qiyamah that my people, some of my people, they deserted the Qur'an. So don't be among those. So then the Shaykh said, I finish with a small mathematical equation here. He said, if a person average lives 60 years, if you sleep 8 hours every day, that is one third of your life spent asleep. That's 20 years of your life is spent sleeping. And then you have, if you work or study another 8 hours, that's another third of your life is gone busy, being busy. So that's two thirds of your life, 40 years of your life. Then the Sheikh said, from the time of birth until a person is 15 or 16, that's another 15 years, that he doesn't know what to do. There is no taklif or anything like that. So that's 55 years out of 60 years. So you only have 5 years, and guess what? You know, 3 out of those 5 years you spend eating and doing other things. So if you eat, if you spend 2 hours every day, you know, meals and other things, so that means, you know, you only have 2 years of your life to worship Allah Azza wa Jal, to do the ibadah. And this is a very dangerous thing. They have a lot to do, but so little to do it. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, no people gather in the gathering without mentioning Allah and saying Salah on Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If people don't do those two in any of their gathering, it is like they were sitting on a carcass of a donkey, a dead donkey. So you don't want to be among those. So they will always regret this and they will be in the Mashiach of Allah, the will of Allah, whether He punishes them or He forgives them. So follow this advice inshallah and use your youth properly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you bi'ithnillah ta'ala. هل التعامل بالبيع والشراء بلحم الخنزير حلال أم حرام؟
إذا حرم الله شيئا حرم ثمنه. إذا حرم الله شيئا حرم ثمنه. حرمت عليكم الميتة والدم ولحم الخنزير. فما دام الله قد حرم لحم الخنزير وقد حرم بيعه وشراءه وأن تستربح من خلاله وأن تهديه إلى أحد من الناس، هذا من الأموال المحرمة لذاتها التي لا يجوز حيازتها ولا يجوز بيعها ولا شراءها ولا هبتها ولا توريثها ولا الانتفاع بها بوجه من الوجوه.
The question is trading, selling and buying the flesh of the swine or khinzir is halal or haram? The Sheikh said if Allah Azza wa Jal makes something prohibited to consume, Allah make it prohibited to trade and gift and use it in any transaction. So if you are prohibited to consume it, it is prohibited to deal with it, period. And this is one of the things prohibited for its own substance, for its own, for no reason other than it is forbidden for itself. So avoid that, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you, inshallah. Shaykhuna, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. في كتاب الدعاء المستجاب للشيخ الشعراوي رحمه الله يقول في حديث القدسي عبدي أطعني تكن عبدا ربانيا تقول للشيء كن فيكون. رأي الشرع في هذا الكلام وهل هو مخالف لرأي أهل السنة والجماعة؟ The question is, there is a book called The Accepted Dua by one of the sheikhs, and he said that there is a hadith Qudsi says, oh my lord, oh my servant, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, oh my servant, obey me, you will be a godly servant of mine. When you say to something, be, and it will be. What is the opinion of the Sharia in this, and if it is different from the Quran and Sunnah?
أما لفظ هذا الحديث على هذا النحو فلا أعرف له أصل. أما معناه فإن المعنى يمكن أن يستدل له بحديث صحيح خرجه البخاري في صحيحه: ما تقرب إلي عبدي بشيء أحب إلي مما افترضته عليه، ولا يزال عبدي يتقرب إلي بالنوافل حتى أحبه، وإذا أحببته كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به، وبصره الذي يبصر به، ويده التي يبطش بها، ولئن سألني لأعطينه، ولئن استعاذني لأعيذنه، وما ترددت عن شيء أنا فاعله، ترددي عن قبض نفس عبد المؤمن يكره الموت وأكره مساءته. شخص إذا كان مستقيما على أمر الله عز وجل فإن الله يجعله مستجاب الدعوة، وعد من الله تعالى: ولئن سألني لأعطينه، ولئن استعاذ بي لأعيذنه. فهذا المعنى صحيح، ثابت في صحيح البخاري، وتشهد له كل الشريعة أصولا وفروعا وقواعد ونصوص ونحو ذلك.
الشيخ said that الشيخ said that this hadith, the way it is, literally he does not know any origin for it, but the meaning of the hadith can be supported by another authentic hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said that whoever opposes or become the enemy of a friend of Allah, Allah become an enemy for him. And then this is a longer hadith, but the hadith says that whenever a person is connected with Allah Azza wa Jal by doing the fard and doing the, you know, the obligations, and then doing the preferable things in the sunnah, they will get closer to Allah. And once Allah loves you, then Allah Azza wa Jal will give you power in your eyes and your hands and your actions, and everything will be acting with the will of Allah and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So something supporting that. And at the end of the hadith, Allah Azza wa Jal said, and if he asks me, my servant with that characteristics, if he asks me something, I'm going to respond at once. And if he seeks protection or refuge in me, I'll protect him at once. So this is a promise of Allah Azza wa Jal that whatever you want, you are going to get. Like that quote in that, inshallah. Is it allowed for a Muslim woman to marry a non-Muslim man? Is it allowed to go to that reception?
Muslim woman to marry non-Muslim man. Of course, it is not acceptable. It's totally prohibited.
طبعا لا يجوز للمرأة أن تتزوج. It goes both ways, يعني. So whatever.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يقول الله جل جلاله: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا جاءكم المؤمنات مهاجرات فامتحنوهن الله أعلم بإيمانهن فإن علمتموهن مؤمنات فلا ترجعوهن إلى الكفار لا هن حل لهم ولا هم يحلون لهن. والله جل وعلا يقول: ولا تنكحوا المشركين حتى يؤمنوا ولعبد مؤمن خير من مشرك ولو أعجبكم أولئك يدعون إلى النار والله يدعو إلى الجنة والمغفرة بإذنه. فقطعا هذا عقد منعدم باطل، والتي تفعل هذا إنما تغرر بدينها وتغامر بدينها ودنياها وأمسها وحاضرها ومستقبلها، وتوشك أن تخرج أو أن تخلع ربقة الإسلام بالكلية. هي طبعا إذا استحلت هذا، فإن استحلال المعصية كفر وردة عن الدين بإجماع المسلمين. إن فعلت وهي متأثمة ومتحرجة فقد ارتكبت أمرا من أفحش الكبائر وأشنعها، ولا تزال في زنا دائم ومستمر ما بقيت علاقتها بهذا الرجل.
The Sheikh said Allah Azza Jal says that, O you believers, when the women, the non-believing women, comes to you as believers and they accepted Islam and you made sure that they became Muslims, you cannot return them back to the non-believers again. They are not halal for them, and their spouses are not, they are not halal for each other. Also Allah Azza Jal says in the Quran, and do not give your women to the mushrik or the polytheist men. Those are people who are inviting to the punishment and the hell of hellfire and the punishment of Allah, while the believers are inviting you to get to the reward and the pleasure and the Jannah of Allah Azza wa Jal. So the Sheikh said it is for sure prohibited, and any woman who would do that, she is risking not only her dunya, her life, but she's risking her deen. If she does that thinking it is okay and it is allowed and ignoring the rule of Islam, she leaves Islam altogether. And this is a consensus of the scholars. She's not Muslim anymore. But if she does it, knowing it is prohibited, but she does it anyway, she is committing one of the most horrendous major sins. And she is committing adultery as long as she is in that relationship. And this is displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we advise everybody not to even think about that and come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حكم من يجاهر بالمعصية وعندما تنكر عليه يقولون لك لعله أقرب إلى الله منك. What is the ruling of someone who is openly disobeying Allah Azza wa Jal? And when you kind of advise them against it, people will tell you, leave him alone, maybe he is closer to Allah than you.
دائما الحكم الشرعي يبنى على الظاهر، إنما أحكم بالظاهر والله يتولى السرائر. وفيه ارتباط بين الباطن والظاهر في الشريعة. لو صلح قلبه لصلحت جوارحه، لو استقام قلبه لاستقامت جوارحه. إنما أحكم بالظاهر والله يتولى السرائر. نحن لم نؤمن بأن ننقب عن قلوب الناس ولا أن نفتش فيها، لكن أمرنا بأن نجري أحكام الإسلام على الظاهر. من أبدى لنا صفحته بسوء أنكرنا عليه، ومن أغلق عليه بابه وفعل ما فعل فحسابه على الله عز وجل. فطبعا هذا المنطق منطق معكوس. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من رأى منكم منكرا فليغير. فإنكار المنكر شرع ودين مرتبط بالرؤية، أن يكون ظاهرا للمنكر بغير تجسس، معلوما كونه منكرا بغير اجتهاد، يعني منكر قطعي متفق عليه. أما قضية خلافية ليست موضعا لإنكار. فالشريعة تبنى على الظاهر والله يتولى السرائر. فنحن ننكر على المعاصي الظاهرة وحساب أصحابه على الله.
الشيخ said the Sheikh said that we judge by what we see, not what is hidden in the hearts of the people, but there is always a relationship between what is in the hearts and what is out. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I am going to judge with whatever I see in front of me, and Allah azza wa jal is the one who will judge according to what a person has in their heart. But also Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if the heart is clean, if the heart is straight, the actions will also be straight. So when the actions are crooked, that means the heart is not straight. This is the statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But we are not going to judge the hearts of the people, but we are going to judge the actions. Then whoever shows things openly without us going and spying and digging and probing into it, that's fine. We are going to judge based on that. But we are not going to make an extra effort to expose someone so we can judge them. That's also a very important point. It is a shara, it is an order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the order of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to deny bad when you see it. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever among you sees wrong, let them deny it with their hand. If they change it, they can change it. If they cannot, then with their tongue. If they cannot, at least they deny it with their heart. And that was part of iman. So it is a sharia, it is a deen to actually disagree with wrong when you see it. So this logic is a reversed logic to say that don't judge someone because maybe he's closer to Allah. If he's closer to Allah, this is up to Allah. But what I see in front of me, it is against Allah's way, I have to say it is against Allah's way. So this is very, very important, as long as there are two conditions. One, you did not make efforts to expose the wrong. Number two, what you consider wrong is wrong by consensus. It is not something that the scholars differed in. If the scholars differed in, then you be quiet, it's better. Because you know what is accepted here, it's rejected there, but it is among the scholars, the bit among the scholars. So as long as there is a consensus, it is wrong. That's number one. Number two, you don't make extra effort to expose it. So then, you deny. كيفية التوثيق وتحضير الوصية مع من تترك؟ هل هي واجب اختياري؟ How we document and prepare a wasiya, the will, and with whom we leave it, and it is an optional obligation.
ما حق امرئ مسلم له شيء يريد أن يوصي فيه أن يبيت ليلتين إلا ووصيته مكتوبة عنده؟ الوصية تكون واجبة إذا كانت عليك حقوق وتبعات لا تعلم إلا من جهتك. الوصية تكون واجبة إذا كنت تخشى ممن يتولون أمرك من بعد رحيلك أن يعصوا الله عز وجل في تجهيزك وفي تشييعك وفي دفنك، فلكي تتبرأ مما قد يفعله ورثتك من بعدك من بدع أو معاصي بمناسبة جنازتك، ولكي تتبرأ من التبعات عندما تكون عليك حقوق لا تعلم إلا من جهتك. إذا انتفى هذا وانتفى ذاك، الوصية مندوبة مستحبة وليست واجبة. لكن هنا في هذا البلد أيضا ينبغي أن تكتب وصيتك لتبين فيها كيف توزع أموالك من بعدك، لأن الشريعة ليست حاكمة في هذا البلد. إذا مت ولم تبين كيفية توزيع أموالك سوف تجري عليها قوانين هذا المجتمع، فلكي لا تزاحم الشريعة قوانين أخرى ينبغي أن تكتب في وصيتك كيف توزع أموالك من بعدك. وبالمناسبة تجوز الوصية لغير المسلم إذا وجد مقتضى لهذا. لو واحد تزوج زوجة كتابية وظلت كتابية حتى مات، هي ليست من الورثة، لا يتوارث أهل ملتين شتى، لكن يجوز أن يوصي لها بحد أقصى التلت. هي أصلا لو كانت وارثة فإن نصيبها يتردد ما بين الربع أو الثمن، إن لم يكن له ولد فإنها ترث الربع، إن كان له ولد ترث الثمن، باب الوصية مفتوح إلين الثلث. فالأمر في باب الوصية أوسع منه في باب الميراث. أما تتركها مع من دي قضية اجتهادية، لم يأتي في الشرع تحديد لشخص معين تترك عنده وصيتك، هي تتركها عند من تثق فيه، تثق فيه ديانة وأمانة وكفاية. إن خير من استأجرت القوي الأمين، صاحب الدين وصاحب القدرة على تنفيذ هذه الوصية والقيام بحقها بعد الممات.
Sheikh said in regards to the will, there is the hadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. It is a duty upon any Muslim who have something to give to have the wasiyah and do not spend two nights without having the wasiyah with them. So then the Sheikh said it is an obligation on a person that two conditions. One, that there are rights, financial rights or other rights, that would not be known except from you. So nobody else would know. So it's only known from you. Then you have to write those. That's number one. Number two, if you are afraid that those who you are leaving behind you, your heirs, your inheritors, you're leaving behind you, that they will not follow the rules of Islam in preparing you in your funerals and giving the debts and dividing the inheritance and all of that, then you make the wasiyah as well. So if you don't have those two conditions, that means wasiyah becomes a preferable thing. It's something that advised, something preferable. But it's a must if you have one or both of those conditions there. And then the Sheikh said in this country here, in the West, there is another issue, which is the rule of the land does not divide according to the rule of the Islam. So you have to, but they respect your will. So you write in your will how you want your bequest after you, or you want your wealth after you, to be divided. Then it becomes legal and it becomes binding as well. So you write that, otherwise it will go according to the law of the land. Then the Sheikh mentioned something from the contemporary issues that a Muslim can write in their wasiyah also for a non-Muslim. And he gave an example that a Muslim man can marry a non-Muslim woman, a Jew or a Christian, people of the book. But according to the rule of the Islam, the two religions don't inherit from each other. You know, there is no inheritance between the Muslim and the non-Muslim. But in this case here is his wife, the mother of his children. So he can write in the wasiyah. And the wasiyah is up to one-third of the inheritance, which actually will be more than the prescribed one for the Muslim wife. You know, Muslim wife, she will take one quarter if there is no children. She will take one-eighth if there is children. So if she's not Muslim, a man can write in his will as well that he gives her up to one-third, which is in our Islam. Now, to leave it with who, it's up to you, as long as the person is trustworthy religiously and trustworthy morally, and also able to execute the well. He's able to execute the well. So have the ability. Al-Qawi al-Amin means honest and trustworthy and able to perform or to execute what you advise them. Is it permissible to put person's name on the grave, Shahid Yan al-Qur, so that people should not stand or walk on the grave in USA?
Tell me, tell me.
Is it permissible to put a person's name on the grave, كتابة الأسماء على القبور يعني, so that people should not stand or walk over the grave?
لا بأس, بل ينبغي أن يعلم القبر حتى تستطيع أن تزوره. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عندما مات عثمان ابن مزعون جاء بحجر ووضعه على قبره وقال أتعلم به قبر أخي حتى تتمكن من أن تزوره. وزارة القبور من السنة. لا بأس أيضا بكتابة اسمه باعتبار هذا شيء من التعريف, كما عرفه النبي بالحجر عرفته أنت بكتابة اسمه. المشترك بين هذا وذاك إنما هو التعريف. فلا بأس بكتابة اسم الميت على قبره أو بتعليمه بعلامة معينة لتتمكن من زيارته. كنت نهيتكم عن زيارة القبور ألا فزوروها فإنها تذكركم بالموت.
So the Sheikh said that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, when Uthman ibn Maz'un, he died in Mecca, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, after burying him, he put a stone on his grave and he mentioned the reason. He said, I'm putting that stone so I can recognize the grave of my brother in case I want to visit him. So the Sheikh said, if that's the reason and the way that you can recognize the grave of someone to visit them and make dua for them is to write the name, to put a stone and write the name, that's okay, as long as this is your reasoning, inshallah. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves, so now I'm ordering you to visit because it is going to remind you of the akhirah, of the hereafter. So there's no problem, inshallah. هل يلزم الوضوء من الإفرازات المهبلية المتكررة بالنسبة للنساء يعني. Is it a must to do wudu after the vaginal discharges for women that it's repeated?
هذه قضية الخلافية والصواب أنه لا يلزمونها الوضوء.
Okay, so this is a debatable issue, difference among the scholars, but the correct opinion that you don't have to do wudu if this is a repeated thing. ما حكم قصة القزع, قزع الشرح الشعر للأولاد, you know, cutting the hair in a way that it is not even.
القزع هو أن تحلق بعض الشعر وأن تترك بعضه الآخر, ويأخذ فورمات مختلفة الجامع بينها نوع من أنواع المثلة. تحلق بعض الشعر وأن تترك بعضه الآخر, وقد نهى عنه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, ويشتد النهي إذا كان فيه تشبها بغير المسلمين, فيبقى منهي عنه لسببين, لنهي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عنه أولا, ثم لنهيه عن التشبه بغير المسلمين ثانيا فيما هو من خصوصياتهم. فينبغي أن نحافظ على هويتنا, وإن اندماجنا في المجتمعات المعاصرة لا يعني انسلاخنا عن هويتنا. نحن جزء من أمة الإسلام في باب الديانة, وجزء من المجتمعات المعاصرة في باب المواطنة. والمواطنة لا تعني الذوبان ولا تعني التخلي عن الهوية. ينبغي أن يكون اندماجك إيجابيا, تحافظ على خصوصيتك الثقافية والحضارية والدينية, ثم تلتقي مع الناس في المشتركات الإنسانية العامة التي لا تحمل بصمة لأهل ملة بعينها ولا بصمة لأهل دين بعينها.
Sheikh said that قزع that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم prohibited and told us not to have is cutting the hair unevenly by doing part of it shorter too much than the other part. So this is one prohibition here. Not doing it because of the prohibition, the direct prohibition of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the prohibition becomes even grave, more grave, if it is resembling the act of someone who is not a Muslim. So then prohibition is for two reasons now. Because a person is resembling the culture or the behavior or the fashion of a non-Muslim, known for that. Number two, there is a prohibition by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Sheikh said, we have our identity as Muslims. We belong to the greater Muslim Ummah. In the matters or the affairs of the deen, we are part of the Muslim Ummah. In the affairs of the society around you, you are a citizen of the country you live in, and both should be respected simultaneously, and there is no conflict between them. When it comes to your deen, you have to stick to your deen. You follow the rules of your deen. But in the affairs, the civic duties and the affairs, that you share with the humans around you what you are supposed to do as a citizen, your duties as a citizen of the country or the place that you live in, and there is no contradiction in that, especially in the affairs that does not have any religious print on it. This is agreed upon all humans to follow the rules of the traffic, to follow the rules of things, common decency. All of these things are good among everybody. So there is no problem. Be a good citizen. But in the affairs of your deen, stay within your deen. وسؤال يعني يحتاج إلى وقت شوية. كيف يدلل الرجل امرأته وتوضيح معنى استوصوا بالنساء خيرا. How a man should pamper his wife. And how, what is the meaning of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, take care of your women.
اللهم اهدنا
workshop, you know. Sister should answer that better, but it's okay.
الحقوق الزوجية, عقد الزوجية ينشئ حقوقا وواجبات متبادلة. فثمة حقوق وواجبات مشتركة ما بين الزوجين, في مقدمتها المعاشرة بالمعروف. المعاشرة بالمعروف حق وواجب, فهو طريق ذو اتجاهين, من جانب الرجل إلى المرأة ومن جانب المرأة إلى الرجل. ولا يظنن الرجل أن مهمته تنتهي عند حدود توفير الطعام والشراب والكساء والدواء. هذه مصالح لا بد منها, لا قيام للحياة إلا بها. لكن في جوانب معنوية لا تقل في مسيس الحاجة إليها عن الجوانب المادية, إظهار العاطفة وإظهار الحب وإسباغه على أهل بيته, وأن يدعهم يشعرون به ويتذوقون دفء هذه العاطفة. إن الشح بالمشاعر والعواطف لا يقل عن الشح بالدرهم والدينار. الرجل قد يكون شحيحا بعاطفته, وهذا يكون أكثر إيذاء للمرأة من شحه بدرهمه وديناره. إن المرأة كما تعيش على اللقيمات فربما تعيش على الكلمات, وقد تكون حاجتها إلى اللمسات الحانية والكلمات الرفيقة والنظرات المحبة أكثر من حاجتها أحيانا إلى بعض الطعام والشراب والكساء والدواء. فلا تكن شحيحا بعواطفك وبعد شوية تشتكي من التصحر العاطفي, تشتكي من جفاف العلاقة الزوجية, وقل لك يداك أوكتا وفوك نفخ والصيف ضيعت اللبن. هذا هو غراسك لما زرعته بيدك. استثمر عاطفيا كما تستثمر ماديا. إن للجسد حاجاته وإن للروح حاجاتها. للجسد أشواقه وحاجاته, وللروح أشواقها وحاجاتها. وإشباع حاجات الروح لا يقل عن إشباع حاجات الجسد. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كانت تأتيه ابنته فاطمة فكان يقوم لها, يخلي لها مكانه ليجلسها فيه, ينحني عليها يقبلها, يرحب بها مرحبا بابنتي, كأنما يتلذذ بذكر البنوة. يفعل هذا في بيئة ومجتمع كان إذا بشر أحدهم بالأنثى ظل وجهه مسودا وهو كظيم, يتوارى من القوم من سوء ما بشر به. لكن نبينا لم يكن يستقي مشاعره ولا معاييره من وحي البيئة الجاهلية من حوله, بل كان الأمر إنما كان يلقى القرآن من لدن حكيم عليم. وكذلك أوحينا إليك روحا من أمرنا, ما كنت تدري ما الكتاب ولا الإيمان. انتبه إلى البعد النفسي والعاطفي, أشبع شريكة حياتك هذا الجانب, أسبغه عليها، دعها تشعر به، دعها تتذوق ضعمه، دعها تستشعر دفئه، وسوف تجني الشهد والعسل إن شاء الله.
Sheikh mentioned that the contract or marriage contract results in many duties as well as rights. Among the mutual duties is to live with you know, goodness and reasonable goodness with each other, and the man should not think that his duty only to provide food and drink and shelter and medicine and that's it. So the Sheikh said no, there are other spiritual things, there are other moral things, there are emotional duties as well that you are supposed to do. Showing your passion to your wife, showing her your love through your words as well as your actions, make her feel that, cover her with that, shower her with that all the time, and don't be miser with your emotions. A person can be miser with his money, but actually it is worse to be miser with one's emotions. Like our wives, they need the money to survive and they need the money to manage their affairs. They need also love and they need good words and they need expression of good emotions as well to thrive and to function. So the Sheikh said it is not only the body that has needs, the soul also has needs. And what we see around, what you see from your wife, the way she is treating you, it is because what your hands did. You are the one who blew in the fire and you are the one who cooked the meal. So when you eat, you don't complain because you are the one who prepared it. So the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he used to stand for his daughter Fatima when she comes. He will stand up for her to welcome her. He will kiss her forehead and he will say, "Welcome my daughter." You know, enjoying saying my daughter in a community or a society that did not respect females, that actually were against having females. When they have females, they will act in a very jahili, ignorant way, as you know. Their face becomes gloomy and dark as if they have some punishment or something. So in that kind of society, Rasulullah ﷺ wanted to express his feeling. So the Sheikh's point is, in a society that is so material and so bad, that we need to give that to our wives so they thrive and they function right. So this is their rights upon us and this is our duty toward them. So the Sheikh said, make your wife full and satisfied with hearing these words of love and emotion. So inshallah, we're going to do a lot of talk tonight. طيب سؤال برضو شيخنا من نفس النوعية. زوجي دائما يهددني بالزواج الثاني على أصغر خطأ ارتكبته، وهذا يجعلني أشعر بعدم الأمان، فهل يجوز ذلك في الشرع جزاكم الله خيرا؟ سؤال مهم جدا. يعني my husband always the sister asking, my husband always threaten me with marrying another wife for the smallest mistakes I do. Smallest mistake I do. And this makes me uncomfortable and insecure. Is this allowed in Sharia? May Allah reward you.
هذا من الخذلان وعدم التوفيق. هذا من الخذلان وعدم التوفيق. إذا سلب الله التوفيق من عبد سلط عليه لسانه وسلط عليه نفسه. فلا تجعل أمرا أباحه الله عز وجل في إطار معين لا تجعله شيئا مبغضا وشيئا تستخدمه صوتا تجبر به من جعله الله جل وعلا تحت ولايتك، يعني فتبغض إلى الناس أمرا الله جل وعلا قد أباحه من حيث المبدأ. ورقم اثنين، في مجتمعات تجرم التعدد لا ينصح بالتعدد إلا إذا كان هناك ظروف خاصة جدا تقتضيه، إنما أنت تعيش في مجتمع يرى هذه القضية جريمة، وإذا تقدمت للحصول على جنسية هذه من القضايا الرئيسة التي يتحرى منها من يستقبلك ويجري مقابلة معك ليتأكد أنك مش فقط يعني لا تمارس هذا ولا تريد ولا مر بخيالك ولا حلمت به في الليل. يعني ففي مجتمعات تجرم التعدد لا ينصح به، ونحن بهذا لا نحرم ما أحل الله عز وجل، لكن فقط ننصح والشخص قد يتجاوز عن بعض المباحات. وعن بعض الأمور التي شرعها الله عز وجل تحقيقا لمصلحة أكبر أو دفعا لمفسدة أعظم، وتبقى الضرورات تقدر بقدرها وتبقى الحاجات تقدر بقدرها. ومن سوء
إنك داخل طالع تهدي بالزوجة بهذا، هذا سوء خلق وسوء العشرة وسوء.
نعم. She said this is a person who is not supported by Allah عز وجل. If Allah supports someone, Allah عز وجل makes him say the right thing and do the right thing. And if the support of Allah عز وجل is taken away, then your tongue becomes your worst enemy. And this is one of those examples where someone threatened his wife with something that Allah عز وجل allowed. Don't use something that Allah عز وجل allowed as a threat, as a whip to, you know, especially for those who are under your care. So they end up hating the deen of Allah, the rules of Allah, and the, you know, permissions or the permissible acts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is number one. Number two, the Sheikh said in society is that it criminalizes this, so it does not allow this. So we're not supposed to do it, except if it is an ultimate necessity, and not for everyone, and not, especially if there are many things, and your citizenship here in this country is based on that. Not only not doing it, but denying it, not even thinking about it, not even considering it. And this is what happens in your reason, so and so on. So we are not prohibiting something that Allah allowed, and we are not allowing something that Allah prohibited. But a Muslim is always balancing between, you know, these two issues here. So sometimes we abandon permissible things and for a better or a bigger good to achieve. And the necessities will, I mean, necessities and needs would be estimated according to its context and according to what it is to do. But this act is not living with your spouse in goodness, and it is bad manners, bad character to threaten your wife with such a thing. So yeah, this is not something advised. And may Allah help the sister, and may Allah guide her husband. ما حكم احتفال أولادنا بعيد الميلاد هم في المدارس؟ ما العلم هم في المدارس الحكومية؟ Celebrating for our children at the Arab school, more than the Arab school. We have that around the
world. الاحتفال بأعياد الميلاد يعكس تبعية ثقافية في الجملة، ليس من شريعتنا وليس من ثقافتنا. لكن على كل حال ليست هي الأعياد العامة المنهي عنها، مثل قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن لكل قوم عيد وهذا أيضا. الإسلام عيش هنا عن أعياد عامة كالفطر والأضحى التي يحتفل بها المسلمون جميعا في وقت واحد. أما هذا على مستوى البيت إظهار الفرح بموت أو كذا، نحن نحب أن تطور هذه المسألة. نحتفل بالوقت إلى وضع سن التمييز، وبالتالي نعلمه الصلاة ونعلمه يعني كيف يتحلى بالآداب الشرعية إذا أنجز أجزاء حفظ القرآن الكريم أو نحو ذلك. أمر لا نحبه في الجملة الأعياد الميلاد، لكننا لا نقول بتحريمه لأنه ليس هو من جملة الأعياد التي نهت عنها الشريعة، لأن الأعياد التي نهي عنها أعياد عامة لكل قوم عيدا، وهذا عيدنا في الإسلام الفطر والأضحى والأحكام. أما على مستوى البيت والأسرة، أرجو أن تكون في دائرة الرخصة، لكن في الجملة تعكس التبعية الثقافية. نحب أن نطورها وأن نؤسسها على عادات تنبثق من حضارتنا ومن منظوماتنا الدينية والحضارية.
She said that celebrating birthdays, it is not from our Islamic culture, it's not from our Islamic tradition, and it is not from the Sharia of the Islam. With that said, still it is not among the prohibited celebrations that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam referred to, other than Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. They are the celebrations that all Muslims observe at the same time. So if there is anything similar than that, similar to that, other than that, this is the prohibition of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But celebrating birthdays is something personal. It is within the family. Even keeping in mind that this is the culture and the ritual and traditions is not ours. But it is not haram. You cannot say it is haram either. It's just that the good thing would be to Islamize it, to give it some other flavor, like you know, celebrating when a child reaches puberty, for example, teaching them what to do and what is required from them, and giving them some gifts and doing some party and celebration and all that. Someone finished Quran or succeeded in school or achieved something, then we can do this. But in general, it is not from our culture, so we don't like it in general, but we cannot prohibit it in general either. So keep that in mind, but we take our celebrations from our religion and from the culture and the identity of the Muslim. زوجتها تحب مخالطة مع رجال أي صورة من الصور إلا في قدر ما تحتاج أو أقل، هل من حقها أن أنكر عليها هذا؟ وهي ضوابط الاختلاط مع ذكر أمثلة بعد إذن فضيلته؟
أنا فقط يعني أستغرب لكي أضيف فائدة، إن مجمع فقهاء الشريعة بأمريكا أصدر قراره أو توصيته بشأن الاحتفال بأعياد الميلاد، وجدتها معي على الهاتف أقرأ عليكم نص قرار المجمع. الاحتفال بأعياد الميلاد في نطاق الأسرة لا يظهر قياس أعياد الميلاد على الأعياد التي تعد من جملة الشعائر والمناسك كالفطر والأضحى، لأن هذه أعياد عامة بخلاف الميلاد. لكن فالاحتفال بهذه الأعياد تبعية ثقافية، صح المسلمون بجنابها مع التأكيد على أهمية إدخال السرور على الأطفال في مناسبات شتى، كلما أحرزوا نجاحا أو تفوقا، وربما يحتفل بإتمام الطفل 7 سنوات و10 و15 لما في هذه الأعمار من نقلة نوعية امتدت عليها الشريعة، فيذكرون بما في بلوغ هذه الأعمار
So the chef here just follow up to the celebrating of birthdays. This is AMJA, Assembly of Muslim Jews of America. You can find it online as well. AMJA online, one word, .org. You can find this process. And about celebrating birthdays, he said, we find that it is cannot, it's not analogous. The celebrating birthday is not analogous to the other day religious celebrations like Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. They are not analogous to each other. Cannot make an analogy based on that, because they are different. They are general Fitr and Adha. They are general celebrations, unlike birthdays. They are personal, but there is some cultural background of that. We ask the Muslim and advise the Muslim to avoid because of that reason, not because of a religious reason. But we emphasize on the importance of making children happy in any way possible, in different occasions as much as possible, whenever they succeed or achieve something. Maybe when they become 7 years, 10 years, 15 years, because you know there are this is a shift in those times. These are landmarks. There are you know stages in their life, so we can celebrate and have some celebrations at that time. And in celebratory his wife does not like to communicate or talk or deal with men except as the ultimate necessity and you know as much as she needs. Do I have the right to disagree with her in this, and what is the limits for dealing between genders?
أنا أريد أن تحكم الله جل وعلا على هذه الأمة. الرجال يشتكون من العكس. الرجال يشتكون من العكس من عدم انضباط نسائه في هذا البلد. أما أن يرزقك الله زوجة تحب أن تعيش قول الله تعالى وقربك في بيوتكن. أن يرزقك الله امرأة تحب أن تكون بعيدة عن الفتنة وبعيدة عن الرجال وتظل مسلما لك وأن تكون خالصة لك من دون المؤمنين، فهذه نعمة أرجو أن تحمد الله جل وعلا عليها وأن تشكر. إذا جاء موقف معين أحسست أن أخذها بالتورع يفوت بعض المصالح، ففي هذه الحالة يمكن أن تنصح على قدر هذا الموقف. لكن هذه الروح العامة روح مشرقة وجميلة ينبغي أن تحافظ عليها. إذا أنت تطلبها في مناطق معينة، في حالة معينة، إلى بعض الأثار الجانبية فتكون مصلحتها على قدر هذا الموقف، وأن تحمل وأن تقدر هذه الروح وأن تعتبر الجانبية.
Charles, the last question was not an issue. After many questions, you cannot finish those, but I'll give you what to do, inshallah. Sheikh answered that by saying you should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praise Him, be grateful for the ni'mah of such a wife who is born to mingle and mix with men. Actually, men complain from the opposite. She said that the men always complain from the opposite, being open and outgoing on the account of the women with the men. So in general, you should be thanking Allah Azza wa Jalla that you have a wife who follows the order of Allah Azza wa Jalla to be at home and to find her own herself and not to mix with gender. This is a ni'mah from Allah that you have someone, you are the only man in her life to take care of and you know, be communicate with. But the Shaykh said, if there is a certain situation that her piety and righteousness and her approach would prevent or become an obstacle in achieving something good or something needed, then you advise only for that occasion, but don't advise for the general behavior. General behavior is recommended, is commended, and is important, inshallah. So the Shaykh said, and in general, we thank Allah Azza wa Jalla for that. We have too many questions, mashallah. But يعني we can go ahead and مطلع الفجر ولكن صلاة العشاء inshallah. ولكن عندنا we have online. We have online, inshallah, we will submit all those questions and we will respond to them, inshallah, either through a video between me and the Shaykh, inshallah, and we will post it, or inshallah, there is a website you can ask our brother Ahmed here, and ask him about that, and inshallah, our brother Abdullah, and inshallah, we will give him the questions and they will type it. They will list it and the Shaykh inshallah will respond to it through a video or through writing inshallah. We hope that this is not our last night here. Inshallah, Allah will send you away. I'll say that I'm happy to be with you.